Well, let's see if Energy can go undefeated in terms of not losing a single game, sorry, a single set in the SPL once again this split, or will Cyclone be the ones to finally put Energy to bed?
It's, man. Who would have, like, this is just so cool. That's all I can think about. It's like, who would have guessed? This split has been so full of parity, and that's what breeds good competitive atmosphere, is you never know who's going to win on any given day.
Completely agree. And that's what the best thing about the LANs coming up will be as well, because four teams in each group and every single one of them go to Super Regionals. Terra banned out, though, by Energy this time. They're not going to deal with that, and they don't want it themselves. Nemesis in response from Cyclone.
If Cyclone do win this game and they don't tweet out easy game, easy life, I'm going to be really disappointed. You need to, don't you?
Idea.
You need to.
I guess you do.
It's Europe. I mean, that's like, that's like normal.
That's out true.
There.
I mean, it's good hard banter.
Yeah, so. I mean, yeah, of course. No BM intended, of course.
No, of course not. No. There's always underlying BM with banter.
Right.
Just remember that one. Susano has been banned by Energy as well.
Does that mean you
never once. It's banter, mate. It's fine. Nemesis banned out. As I said, Cyclone now have one more. Do you reckon it's going to be Fafnir here?
Yeah, Fafnir would be a solid ban here. Energy not wanting to deal with that Terra at all. You could go with Fafnir. You could even go with, say, a Thor. We saw them ban Alquang last time.
It's true.
You don't want to face the wrath of the angry adapting.
Well, he's got a lot of options on the table because, as we said, Fafnir now available, Alquang available. And actually, real respect for the Isis ban of all things.
Very surprising because Wolfie just had such a great game on it. Yeah. And you don't think that Energy's going to first pick it, right? So
no.
I guess whatever Cyclone's planning on picking, it does not work with Isis or against Isis.
I mean, unless Energy, you know, unless Cyclone thinks that Energy are so respectful of what Wolfie did on that in that game on the Isis that they would just take it away from him.
But that's great for them, isn't it?
That's true, I guess.
You want them to do that because then you get Fafnir and right. You get Fafnir Raijin, you get Fafnir whatever you want.
That's true. Well, they're gonna get Raijin anyway, and they're also gonna lock in Freya as well. A little bit early for that Freya pick, but I guess that's also to make sure the Fafnir Freya combo is not in effect.
But you still have the Fafnir Soul, the Fafnir Kronos. Fafnir pairs very well with those magical ADCs, and there's still a lot on the table.
What do you want to see Adapting play this time? You said Thor, you know, before we go
Alquang
into this.
Alquang is fine, too.
You happy with Alquang?
Yeah, I've got no complaints.
I can see that. I want to see what Isis Baby does against this thing, because we've seen a lot of Sir Ket just lately when Alquang's been locked in. And I have a feeling Yamin's like, okay,
we're done with this. I went, like, 2-0 last game, did top damage, couldn't do enough. Give me Chiron.
Got to put my carry pants on.
Yeah.
And by doing that, he has four legs, so...
Right, carry pants have two extra legs. They're a little hairier, but they work really well. And there it is, the Sir Ket, the kind of counterpick to Alquang.
The only problem with this composition, though, already from what the Cyclone have drafted, it's very squishy already. And the last two picks have to be a little bit tanky for themselves.
And Alquang just eats squishy targets, all the time. Adapting probably knew the Sir Ket was coming. I mean, he plays Sir Ket into Alquang constantly. And that's one of the advantages. When you are the one who does the opposite, usually, you know what they're going to be trying to do to you.
And you know how to deal with that matchup in the reverse side of things.
You know, you're like, okay, I'm Sir Ket, and then you go up against an Alquang, and they crush you even though they shouldn't, and you think, oh, so that's how I have to play it whenever I'm Alquang. So having that experience on the other end definitely translates well to the opposite.
A bit of a mix-up in terms of the counterbands there, too. And hers is definitely not what's going to be coming out here, so that'll be corrected momentarily.
We're working our butts off out here, Peckies. What are you doing?
Blame Peckies.
Come on, dude.
Blame Peckies. It's fine. But at the same time, when I look at this, I expect to see some Guardians coming out, and there we go. It is going to be a Kefri on the side of Energy here. Basically, just to focus out Kallus a little bit, because he's going to have to be some sort of front line. And when I say front line, the Kefri's kind of a back line support, but at the same time, it does allow Sir Ket Frey to go ham.
Definitely. Just throwing out that Scarab's Blessing on her, just no worries in the world. Just go do your thing. You'll be able to come back to me if you die. But that doesn't really feel so much like Kallus. He likes these aggressive supports, right? Yeah. Ares, Bacchus, that sort of stuff.
He's European, man. That's just what they do.
Right. They don't like Kefri. They don't like supporting. They like doing damage in the support role.
And I think that Sun Wukong could potentially be flexed to the support role because of that as well, to support Freya a little bit in the
early stages. Because you have that Freya, you're not worried about being too heavy on the physical damage, allowing you to have that kind of warrior in that dual lane. Mm-hmm. Having the dual damage is kind of important in the mid game. But they banned the way the Kronos. They were worried about that magical ADC, but they left Soul open, and I'm surprised because if they had gone on her there, Energy, then they would have four physicals or three physicals, but it's only Alquang doing damage. It's not the same as like a mage with your guardian, right? Mm. So it makes them a little bit physical heavy, not much, not like, oh man, this comp is terrible. I can't believe they didn't think about it, but it is, you know, it's in the back of your mind. You can kind of stack physical protection fairly easily, but electing to ban that on her and leaving the Soul open, which is kind of the obvious pick.
Isn't that though just because of like the lane matchup in terms of how aggressive you can be on a Nanhe versus a Sol, I guess?
Yeah, letting Freya get some early breathing room, if you will.
And Nanhe's great against Freya as well.
Definitely a good point.
Well, Kumakana will be the final pick there for Kalis, so it will be Sun Wukong in the solo lane for Deathwalker here as we go into game two with energy down a game. I don't get to say that too often.
No, you don't. And it's fun because then we get to see Angry adapting or like Dark adapting.
Mega Angry adapting.
Yeah. Like kind of like a Yu-Gi-Oh sort of thing where he's like all nice and happy and then he goes into that different state and his voice gets all deep and he looks all mad.
I hate you all.
He's going to send them to the Shadow Realm.
Well, Yamin's playing that lovely moose skin in the mid lane again.
That is like the best skin. That's my favorite skin, I think.
It's very realistic to every Canadian I have ever heard.
I don't think they're going to appreciate that.
No. I know one Canadian, I think, and that's Harris Amanda. She sounds like that.
Does she?
A little bit.
Does she wear like red a lot with maple leaves?
No, but the horns.
Isn't Snoopy Canadian?
Yeah, and Jeff Hitler.
Yeah. No.
No, Jeff's Canadian.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I'm sorry.
Don't get it wrong.
God. For some reason, I was thinking New York, but there's no way he's from New York.
Not at all.
Clearly from Canada.
Only people like FDOT from New York.
What is that supposed to mean?
That's all it needs to mean. But the wards have been placed down by both teams, though. Cyclone, as you can see, they've got three deep wards here. Very worried about a potential invade coming out from Energy.
Yeah, Raffer definitely did not go for that same route. You can see decided to let that one go this time. And worried about that potential invade. But mostly on those bottom right-hand mids, you can still go around if you wanted to invade. But with the comp that Energy has, I don't think the invade was particularly likely. Really looking to see where they're going once they clear the wave in middle lane.
Now, we mentioned a bit about the Sirkhet versus Alquan matchup as well, Aggro, and it's generally down to the fact that we've seen a lot of these teams pick it as a counter matchup, Sirkhet favoring against the assassin of Alquan and looking to shut him down every time he tries to engage here. How do you play against that then, if that's this style?
You mean as the Alquan? How does Alquan play against it? You just look to be nowhere near Sirkhet. You let Sirkhet go on to other characters, almost bait characters like Yamin and Emilito. Let Sirkhet go on them, and then just go in whenever you can.
A lot of aggression already, and it looks like Dimmy could be in trouble again, but he's going to finish away. No! Wolfie denies it. Thunder, crash, good night, sweet prince. 1-0, first blood to Cyclone again.
Wolfie just outcleared Yamin in middle lane, allowing him to get to those fire elementals significantly earlier. Yamin was on the way, but Chiron's early clear, not that great. He needs levels on that first ability in order to clear the wave efficiently, whereas Wolfie can almost insta-clear.
I mean, we mentioned the respect that a lot of people have for Wolfie in the mid lane. He's done the grind in terms of the Challenger Cup to get to the SPL here, but he's really showing that he's not as scared of who he's against in mid lane. He knows the matchups well. That Thunder Crash is not something everybody would do to Yamin in any given situation.
No, you think about it, and you're like, yeah, I do this in my ranked games, but that's Yamin. Hold on, that thought actually is adapting, taking a lot of poke from Ice Ice Baby, taunting him into the minion wave.
And very lot of poke on that, so I'm going to fall back into the jungle there. Adapting is out of potions here as well. Does have one ticking away, however, and Bumba's Mask will help.
Not only that, but the passive from Chiron's going to be able to heal him up on these back harpies and the middle lane as well. Chiron just brings a lot in the middle lane. It helps your jungler out a good amount.
I mean, that heal is still there, and in effect, it's not as significant as it used to be in the old days when it was very, very strong and used to stack up multiple times and even refresh. Yeah. But now, you know, it's still going to be impactful. You don't feel it as much, but it's definitely still going to tick.
You're definitely going to get a tick. Look, adapting almost full health there, but he is out of mana, so he does have to be wary about that. And Wolfie, electing to go for two health pots there, kind of stopped their aggression a little bit almost, because he used so much mana getting that first blood, going in aggressively on that first wave. Without any mana sustain, the Soul Stone, you need to just kind of sit there and let it happen. It's all MP5 as opposed to actual mana back in your pocket immediately with something like a Vampiric Shroud. Does back and get the boots too, but I don't know. I prefer to get one and one. Maybe he thought he was going to get poked out a little bit by Yamin. You can go either way.
At the same time, though, if you're worried about a matchup potentially taking a lot of poke there, and then you get a Haunter, maybe it's wise just to go for the safe option with two health.
And you don't get any health regen with the Soul Stone like you do with that Vampiric Shroud. Definitely a personal preference thing, but Wolfie, I mean, it's still fine because you get the boots too. Right, you get the boots too. Now you've got the extra movement speed, the extra damage, and it increases their invade potential now that the buffs are coming up.
Well, the very greedy dwarf at the moment has already gone back to base once, is Irafa, and he's already picked up the reinforced greaves very early on to go with the Watcher's Gift. Adapting, he's around on the left-hand side here, but Cyclone had an understanding something may be coming on.
Fafnir is one of the characters that benefits most from the reinforced greaves changes, in my opinion, because he doesn't have to worry about getting extra gold, because he'll get it anyways from his passive.
Oh, but he's in trouble now. Dimmy forced to use the Lawbringer there to try and help defend this people. If this already been stolen by Cyclone, you can see that obviously Adapting was on the other side of the map here, so Cyclone balloon, do an in and out, run and gun, get the objective and leave.
And Wolfie just stood there in front of two people and just said, yeah, get past me. You know, I'm going to defend my teammates getting this speed buff. And here's the response from Energy, looking like they want to go towards this red buff, but Vodan BK is already on it.
But how quickly can they get down? No, he will get it down, but then immediately forced to ultimate as Adaption does collapse on him. Great poke, though, on to the Ao Kuang there coming out and defending the red buff, the most important thing there.
Definitely. Getting that experience and gold for your team, really, really important. So that's worth trading your ultimate for some poke and securing the red buff. And you don't want to have to use that ultimate anyways if you're Vodan BK.
Yeah.
You want to be able to save it four times when you really need it, just like that.
He's going to be a little bit careful now in this laning phase, because if Fafnir just hang around here, even Ao Kuang now as well, he's only got purification to really defend himself about any aggression that Energy could look for. But he's still a great position of Cyclone to be in now.
Yeah, up about 1,000 gold, right, at four minutes, getting that first blood. And now's when that lead should start to materialize. Get it? You want to be able to bully out the other people from the mid harpies, from the fire elementals. You can see right now, Ice Ice Baby on the back right harpies, taking everything they can, just extending this little lead into a slightly bigger one.
I mean, you mentioned it as well, as the Ao Kuang, you want to stay away from Circuit as much as possible. And, well, Adaptin's doing that, but at the same time, he is losing his jungle because of it.
That's right. Ice Ice Baby knows that, right? He knows that he doesn't want to be anywhere near him. So if he's on the left side, fine, I'll take his speed buff. And if he wants to get a speed buff, I'm going to be there to meet him. I'm going to be where he wants to be so that he can't be away from me.
Well, both the Hunters back to lane. Both Mages this time round as well. Amelito looking to farm. Went for the Soul Stone here for the extra little bit of burst clear and extra damage that comes with that one as well. Meanwhile, Vodan BK going for the standard Fatalis start.
Not worried about any poke really is Amelito. Now Ice Ice Baby coming in for the gank, but the Supernova off the mark. Tried to time it, but Amelito sniffed it out and used that to separate perfectly.
It did slow him down though, at least that Supernova, because obviously it will knock up. So just at least giving him a small window. But look at the response that was there from Rafa and Adaptin that time. They were there in a moment's notice.
They were ready. They knew, and that's just experience, right? You know, you're like, I could probably get ganked right now. And then sure enough, there they are. So Adapting and Raffer right there to support him just in case.
Well, Yami's got his Transcendence online now and stacking. And we've seen some of the snipes he can really do on this Chiron throughout the days that he's been playing this god. Through the wall, hitting multiple people. And even when you think he's out of range, he's still finding him.
Dude, I want to be Yami when I grow up. He's just, so good. He's so amazing. Good at the middle lane. And I love playing Chiron middle and because of the skin and because of Yamen. And I try and do it, and I'm just like so useless. And I just don't, where does it all, like,
it's
he
okay.
does so well.
It's
I don't
okay.
understand.
You're a caster now. That's okay. You're allowed to be useless.
I'm allowed to be washed up now. Before, it was embarrassing that I was washed up.
It was.
But now, I'm washed up and I'm proud.
Well, Ryan Harpy's being looked at. Kallus going to get a root off there. Going to force Rafa out as he's a little bit worried. But now Dimmy closing in. Going to get the Thunder Crash out of Wolfie there. As Yamen did get a nice little bit of free poke off.
He's okay with that. He's going to be able to sustain. He's definitely willing to trade poke whenever you're Chiron into a Raijin or anything else.
That whole little dance there went in Energy's favor, though, because it did secure that speed buff this time around. They didn't get it stripped away from Cyclone again, so no extension on the gold lead that Cyclone already had.
No, I'm surprised they aren't looking to go for that red buff because they weren't successful on the speed. You may as well try for the other big buff on the left-hand side, especially whenever Vodan BK has lane pressure on that end. But instead, they elect to go for their right-side buffs instead.
Yeah, just going to clear up that. And you can see how many members of Energy on this left-hand side are going for this red buff. Now, four members over here. Like, we want to make sure we get both buffs this time around. We all need the experience right now. Let's split it all up and share it equally.
May as well. It's better than getting it stolen, right? And like you said, all these characters do need a lot of experience. Ao Kuang, definitely more of a late-game oriented character. Yamen's going to need levels and items, more specifically items, in that middle lane on the Hunter in the mid. And then Amelito, obviously late-game soul, also going to be looking for those levels.
And that's the difference between Mages and Hunters as well. I mean, for the most part, Mages, they really are level-dependent for
levels.
Their abilities.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the same time, the other side of things, you're looking for Hunters to have the items online to deal that damage.
And it's an interesting switch-up, knowing that, you know, maybe Yamen is like, oh, I'm big, I'm level 11 when everyone else is level 9.
Yep.
But it's not as impactful as when you are on a Mage. It's more about going for those items.
Big changeup, but look at that walk coverage coming out from Cyclone there, clearing out the Gold Fury one and the one at the left-hand start of the Harpies there in Energy territory, just making sure they control this pit over and over again, and you have to do that against the World Champs.
But their Gold Fury secure is much worse than it was last game. You don't have Apollo to tank it up while you're kind of dancing, allowing your front line to zone. You don't have the Isis ultimate to confirm it, so it's going to be interesting to see how Cyclone plays this differently than they played last game, where they were really willing to do that Gold Fury dance a lot. This time, they probably aren't able to.
Thinking about objective secure as well, I mean, towers is another issue they're going to have this game as well, Cyclone here. Obviously, Freya, not the best at bringing down objectives like a Kronos, like a Sol, or a typical Hunter, whereas, well, Energy have two.
Yeah. Oh, was that the Serket ultimate? Yeah, one of those weird interactions. As soon as adapting goes invisible, Ice Ice Baby tries to use the ultimate on him, and it takes the cooldown. Unfortunate there for Cyclone.
So Ice Ice Baby will limp away for the time being at level 10 at the moment, still grinding away. A little bit of a lead over adapting, though, which is because of those invades, and that Jotuns is near enough online right now. Next trip back to base, he'll definitely have that for himself.
Extra penetration, cooldown reduction, power, the ultimate item for assassins, right? It gives you everything you need, some mana as well. So this is the power spike. Cyclone has the ward coverage. They have the items. Now's where we see how they utilize them. Speed buff's coming up soon for energy. They tried to get it last time, were unsuccessful. Maybe they'll look there, or maybe because energy knows that Cyclone's going to be looking at speed buff, they'll overcommit to the speed buff and they can go for the Gold Fury.
Well, they're hanging around that Gold Fury right about now, looking for somebody maybe looking to place a ward. Kallus can be the first one around the corner to meet Rafa, who's about to come around there. Neither of them knew that until just now. And the poke is up. Around the corner comes Ice Ice Baby one more time, looking for some potential pressure. And they're actually committing onto Yamin here on the right-hand side. And Yamin's isolated and alone. You don't get to say that too much. He's normally very good at escaping, but didn't even get time to purify.
No purification, no ultimate used, just kind of took those ultimates to the face. Did take the Raijin ultimate, but now Raph are going to try and secure this Gold Fury for energy.
Well, he's going to pop the dragon at some point in time there. Going to jump in with nice disarm coming out actually from him, the underhanded tactics, making sure Freya can't poke it down any further. And you can see adapting is in mid lane right now with Dimmy rotating in. Cyclone realizing they can't get any more from this. They're just going to have to take that one kill for now.
And that's because Dimmy's here while Deathwalker isn't. It was usually the opposite last game. Yeah. Deathwalker making the early rotations while Dimmy lagging a little bit behind. This time, Deathwalker going to his own team's speed buff instead of rotating to the potential fight. I guess the call was, we're not fighting anymore, let's just farm up.
So the Gold Fury still stands, and then we're going to go back to farm a little bit more at 10 minutes in. However, Cyclone finding that kill was great. I mean, they just keep finding these picks over and over on targets you don't normally get to say they found a pick on.
No, I mean, Yamin, Chiron, really, really safe god, right? He's got the dash that knocks people out of the way. Oh, nice whoop. Going to try and secure the ward, but not quite enough. If he was there one auto attack earlier, that would have been there. I love, like, ward dances. That's, like, a really, like, uninteresting but really interesting part of Smite.
Well, it's those little plays of realizing how many autos you can get off before you're going to lose the buff. Can you body block against the ward being taken? Do I have the CC to out-trade him? Overall, Left Hand Harpies, though, being contested between both teams there, I should say, quite a few people. As, yeah, we do see this Mystical Mail online for Deathwalker this game, an interesting one.
I'm surprised that he went the Mystical Mail into Dimmy's Reinforced Greaves, because those ticks are going to just build protection for Dimmy.
Oh, hold on a second. This was a great little play. However, the ultimate is available for Deathwalker, but does he know it? The chain is going to drop him in range, and the ultimate will go off in time, but it's not enough. Adapting gets credit for the kill with the swing round the back through the enemy jungle and an answer back from energy.
Not only is it really annoying when you get your back stopped like that and then you die, it's like, at first it's like, okay, Dimmy, calm down. I'm just trying to back. It's not a big deal. But it was a big deal because adapting was coming around the back, perfectly timed there from energy.
Well, at the same time, the rotation to the right and side to defend the tier one has allowed energy to look at the Gold Fury now as well. Only Kallus is here, and that supernova will dissuade him from going in. Free pick up of the Gold Fury to energy. The world champion's back on top.
500 gold only, but whenever you've lost two kills early, you've been losing some buffs here and there. That's big. Getting that early Gold Fury is going to help Yamin get those ever-important items online that we were talking about.
Now, that Mystical Mail, though, we want to go back to it again. You were talking about the Reinforced Shoes, right, about how that's not going to be very impactful and actually give those stacks permanently, potentially, to his lane opponent. Is it not to deal with Ao Kuang, maybe, and bring him out of the illusion?
Definitely. Having that against Ao Kuang, he won't be able to be invisible around you. Probably a huge part of why Deathwalker went for this. But again, Deathwalker likes these really expensive items.
Yeah.
Second, I mean, last game was the Mantle of Discord, and that clearly ended up working out, so I guess we can't harp on that too much. But now going for this Mystical Mail, I wonder if he's going to go Mantle of Discord third.
It's definitely a risk-reward build, though, every time. If you go for an expensive item build and you get behind, you're going to be behind the whole game then. But at the same time, you go for a cost-efficient build. Have that for mid lane Wolfie, Agreston, forced to purify away from a very good Fearless from Dimmy after the blink over the wall.
Dimmy now abusing the fact that his solo lane tower was taken down after the kill onto Deathwalker to now make that free rotation into the middle lane, forcing Wolfie to half health and taking away that purification. Still has a Sanctuary online, but that's not really going to help you against a Blink Fearless.
Yeah, very true. And we're talking about items coming online. There's a lot of things. Book of Toth available for Emilito, now stacking that one up. Meanwhile, VotMBK is pretty much finishing off his core build here on Freya, and that's when she'll start to shine. And the way VotMBK played last game, if you can do anything similar, well, Cyclone are going to be in a good spot.
Definitely. He just was such a big impact on that last game, but a lot of it was using that ultimate to crash rush in at the right time. Yep. And obviously you can't do that as Freya. So we'll see how he positions. It's going to be important for VoteMBK and Wolfie to be in two separate areas of the team fight, but still close enough to get support from their frontliners.
Kind of expected though as well, Aggro, to see both teams generally farming up this game. Obviously looking for positional advantage or potential picks, but there's not been extra pressure. As I say that, Dimmy forced to Lobring. Actually, Lobring's in place, however, though, and then turned on with the ultimate by Ice Ice Baby. The dots coming through, and Kallus waiting around the corner with Wolfie in tow. Dimmy falls down, and the rotation from Energy just a little bit too late, but maybe they want to take this.
Just a little bit too late. Now looking at Ice Ice Baby, is Raffer going to disarm him? Some nice poke there by Yamen, but just not a quick enough response. And Dimmy ulting in place. I don't know if he thought his team was going to be there a little bit earlier. Maybe a misclick. You never know, but probably would have been safer ulting towards the jungle or ulting towards his tower.
It didn't work out for him, so he will fall down for the third kill for Cyclone now. However, Energy, you get those left-hand harpies on there just to get themselves a little bit more experience and strip away some of those contested neutral buffs in the middle lane. Ice Ice with a great kiss there, hitting both the targets, and it's not the easiest thing in the world to do.
That's kind of one of those heat checks. It's like a raw Thor double tap, something along those lines. We just want to see, how am I feeling mechanically this game? Am I feeling good? Yeah, I'm probably feeling pretty good.
Well, Deathwalker actually went back in there onto Adapting, quite surprised, and there's an uppercut in mid lane used by Kallus, and the following drums of war available going to taunt in Yamen, who sanctuaries the first hit, however, and he will stay strong. Wolfie forced out with a Thunder Crash, Ravid giving chase. Snipe through from Yamen, focus onto Kallus. They want the Kumba corner now, and Kumba falls very quickly.
A lot of ultimates used to confirm that kill, though, but Raffer in that dragon form going to be able... The tower siege right now from Energy is so strong. Yeah. We talked about how bad it was on the other end, but here's
fearless,
the great blink fearless
again.
From Wolfie.
Wolfie alive for one more second with the Sanctuary. Can he get out? He will with a Thunder Crash, and the shot will not be enough to bring down Ice Ice Baby either. Dimmy was thinking about going in, but now Deathwalker rotating into support. This is great for Energy, though. They can look at this tier one, force three members back.
Man, it's still great, yes, but that is like 10 HP on two characters combined. Unfortunate that neither fell. And like I was about to say, Cyclone really lacking in the tower siege department. Anything but for Energy. You've Soul, you've got Chiron, you've got Fafnir, and God forbid if Fafnir decides to go Frenzy.
Yeah,
and that'd be awesome.
Well, I mean, just think about when he hits both of them with the Coerce at the same time. It's like there's no towers that are going to stay standing for very long whatsoever.
It's going to be blink and your towers are gone, and that's such a big thing. I mean, Energy can afford to take some even fights and then just take objectives, whereas Cyclone has to win these fights hands down in order to get towers.
Well, Cyclone is trying to siege this tier one in response, but there's still four members of Energy here, and I think Cyclone recognized that a little bit there, because around the corner was Dimmy just hanging and saying, listen, if you got to commit again, we'll go one more time with 4v3 this time.
Dimmy just kind of going for this tanky, I'm just going to displace you and there's not a whole lot you can do about it build. The reinforced greaves directly into some more protection, Pestilence, and Breastplate of Valor. You'll see some tiers go for Jotun's Wrath, you know, really liking that cooldown and power option, or you'll see Chapo go for Transcendence because he's weird and no one understands him. But Dimmy going for this type of build, definitely more worried about the CC because that team has enough damage as it is.
Well, I mean, Dimmy, for the most part, on this team of Energy, he is the spot filler for this team. He gets put in a lot of negative matchups most of the time and expected to lose lane most of the time. His job is basically weather the storm in solo lane against whoever you're against, maybe get soloed a couple of times off some solo kills yourself, but for the most part, wait for their team fights and then make the impact, which we really need.
And that's kind of a fun style, right? It's like, if I lose, whatever. I've still got Adapting and Yamen and Emilito here. Or, you know, if the other team decides to camp Emilito and allow Dimmy to get a winning matchup or something that he can just kind of go off on, that's a lot of fun for him, too. So having that wide God pool is definitely a big part of why Energy's so successful.
Well, Cyclone, looking at the goal viewer here from now, positioning around it with Kumbakon on the front side here. They can get a good CC chain and Kumbakon, and not too bad against Al Kwong at all for shutting him down out of the fight. But the same can be said for Rafa shutting down some of these carries and giving his team a bit of a boost. Left harpies go the way of Energy.
Both teams have a lot of CC right now, and that's something that's important. We see some drafts that are a little bit lacking in the CC and allows you to get greedy with your relic usage and that kind of stuff, but not the case here. Tons of CC. You've got stuns, you've got mezzes, you've got roots, you've got taunts. You've got it all on this game.
So what's the big power play coming out from Energy now? What's the power level spike that we see? Because in the old days, Energy have always been like, 15, 16 minutes, boom, goes the dynamite. And we kind of saw that at that tier one tower.
We are really close right now. Tier about to get a Winged Blade online or a Ritual Dagger possibly, but probably the Winged Blade. Hold that thought though. Cyclone recognizes energy's going to be busy farming, going for the Gold Fury.
He's
going to
get committed on very quickly there. They're going to force him away with the taunts. Gold Fury goes the way there of Cyclone, I believe. And now they're going to try and disengage as well. But in comes Emilito. Stellar Burst on the mark will pick up one. And now they're going to chase in looking for
nice
another
group.
As well.
Nice double whoop, stops the aggression onto Wolfie there. And here comes the power play from Energy, though. They've got this tower siege composition. They just use so much on the Gold Fury. I wouldn't be surprised if both of these left-hand towers go down.
Yeah, left one will go down straight away. And with five members being here, Aggro, as you said, they can definitely get a tier two. Now, Deathwalker actually going to choose the base. No, change his mind now. Now I'm going to take that tier one just to answer back a little bit of that gold deficit. And that should bring us to an even game, I want to say, overall here.
Overall, pretty much even. Definitely the right call by Deathwalker to not back there. And there's no way Energy's going to push for the Phoenix, and you'd still have time to back if they did decide to do that. So you may as well guarantee your team some gold. But this is what's so scary about Energy's comp. Yes, we got the Gold Fury, but we just lost two towers instantly. If we're just a little bit poked out, there's no sustain on that team. There's no way for them to combat this tower siege from Energy.
I mean, see, I said even, but it's still slightly favoring Energy, especially because of the fact where those two towers went down as well. The furthest lane away from the Fire Giant is always the best lane to take the objectives if you can.
Especially whenever there's going to be a big fight around the Gold Fury next. You know when that Gold Fury respawns in a little under 4 minutes, that's going to be the next major fight, right? Yep. So not having any towers for them to go to is big.
Kalos blinks in, gets a Yawn on two, looking at Emily to Yamini, both purify away. Deathwalker giving chase, going to stun out Rafa, but under the tower, they're not going to commit Cyclone there. They're just happy with a bit of poke and getting two purifications off two prime targets.
That's a big play from Kalos, getting both of those purifications, as you mentioned. That's like a two-minute window now where the two biggest damage dealers outside of adapting, Emilito and Yamin, don't have their biggest defensive relic available. And that means that Wolfie can just kind of taunt them in, get the damage for free, or if Ice Ice Baby catches them out, they've got nothing they can do.
They try to make a big play there on that right-hand side as well, onto Ao Kuang, onto Adapting. We're not going to find it. They're looking to siege the tier one tower in mid, and Dibby's having none of it. Lawbringer's in with Rafa following up. Round the back is Adapting, though. Sneaky, sneaky, that jungler. He'll be looking for someone to get poked out. Meanwhile, Deathwalker keeping him busy on the front, and Vote MBK forced his ultimate, panicking a little bit too much there. But now that's down. Dibby's going
what
in again, and they're looking for the monkey.
Now Ice Ice Baby going to go in, try and help out Deathwalker up into the cloud he goes. Yamin Sanctuary is popped, and Adapting still just waiting in the jungle.
Rafa still taking a lot of poke here, but still has his ultimate available as well. Meditate used there as well, just to heal up a little bit more. Don't forget Coerce heals him too. Energy marching on, and Wolfie took a bit of free poke for nothing there.
Yeah, I don't know about that positioning. Wolfie trying to clear the wave, but puts himself in a really bad spot. And here it is. And Cyclone gets a little bit poked out, and here comes the tower siege from Energy.
Well, they've got a lot of minions there, but Kalos takes a lot of free poke from Emilito, positioned perfectly. Rafa to the back, gonna force out Vote MBK. And Kalos does ult the Fafnir, and now he's gonna try and get his ultimate off, but can he? He does in time, so the Drums of War don't do anything. Energy in a very good spot still. Cyclone investing a lot into Rafa, and now Rafa's going to reinitiate with a full minion wave coming as well.
Dimmy just so tanky with that build, not able... Cyclone can't do anything against him. Another Lawbringer in a
great
huge supernova.
And he immediately dips back out again, but in goes Ice Ice Baby, looking to distract and maybe clean up a kill. Getting chased down by two targets, though, and Yamin's in hand. He doesn't necessarily need too many of those, as Adapting will get credit for the kill, and now this tier 2 in mid will fall.
That fight took so long. I mean, that was a 25-30 second fight, and now it looks like Energy's going to turn their sights. Not only do they have great tower siege, they've got great objective killing potential as well, right onto the Fire Giant.
Yeah, Fire Giant is already starting to hit half health already, and nobody from Cyclone will be back in time to defend this one as well. Deathwalker's going to limp his way into the jungle. Guys? Oh, maybe you can.
Oh, he's got this.
Can you steal this? No, you didn't even need Jingle Bang. Watch this.
Mystical
actually,
Mail Steal.
No,
mystical
he gets mail. A kill on Yamin. That's actually really good for themselves, honestly. Picking up one, disrupting them, taking out a damage dealer, now pressuring him with his team, been back up. This worked out well for Deathwalker now. In comes Kalos with a blink, closing the gap, Yawn on two, forcing out Sanctuary, and there goes the cloud, looking for Emilito a little bit more.
Got to pick up Emilito here with that Fire Giant. This is such an important kill. Is able to get out. Deathwalker... I don't know. I guess he wanted more health.
Credit to Dimmy, I think, was the key there. Dimmy Lawbringer, I think, at the same time as he expected the Sun Wukong to dismount, he would have hit him with a chain.
So hot.
So I think that's why he stayed that extra second, because Dimmy's Lawbringer just had to be cast a little bit earlier. He recognized it.
Deathwalker just going in 1v4, plus the Fire Giant on his side, helping out against Yamin. That's a big character to get that Fire Giant off of. But still, Yamin only level 16, Emilito level 18, solving that Fire Giant's big. Ooh. Looking for the invisible Ao Kuang. He was close,
he was close, but not close enough. And now the turnaround is here because Dimmy's looking at Ice Ice. The burst is real, especially with a Polynomicon being online for the Alquan now. Demi, credited for the kill and deserves it.
That was cute. It's like, that was cute, Ice Ice Baby. That was a nice try. Pat you on the head as I blink Fearless you into your death.
Well, the Gold Fury's just spawned now as well, and with energy, getting that Fire Giant. Don't forget, they did get that, even though they disengaged off of it as well. They can choose a lot of options available to them. Only two tier two towers remaining, and all the Phoenixes are standing too.
And both of these are going to go down so quickly that this Fire Giant's going to feel like an eternity again for Cyclone. They just won't have any defense against this push.
Not only that, with Ice Ice Baby being dead as well, the front line is a little bit weakened now as well, as the Phoenix is being sieged down, but Kallus back to the front. Don't forget, the sleep does reduce attack speed, as Freya did use her ultimate there looking for a pick on Yamin, but Yamin's still alive.
Don't forget that Raiju does reveal Alquan, even in stealth, to all of your teammates, so that's something to keep in mind. Wolfie not even popping it just so he can have the vision.
Well, the Phoenix is still standing for now. Wolfie using his ultimate early on there. Rafa taking a lot of free poke, but still able to coerce to heal up a little bit more. This is okay defense from Cyclone, though.
They're okay with this, definitely. Now Energy maybe thinking a little bit better of their strategy, going for this right-hand tier 2 is on the table. We're going to strip away the speed buff first.
Speed goes down, giving over to Adapting one more time. Much better performance from Energy this game, although still credit to Cyclone this game as well. I mean, even though Energy are in the lead aggro, they're still putting on a great show.
It's a 6-4 game. It's been a lot of push and pull, and I think that the draft was just a little bit off for Cyclone, and Energy really just found a really great draft to go with. Maybe the Freya, you should give them the Freya, because then the tower push isn't as strong.
It's true, but around the back comes Cyclone. They're looking to wrap it on Energy, and Energy are looking to back there as well. Separate Odie down from Emilito. Lobbering on the mark from Dimmy. Didn't really hit anyone. Emilito dealing with two, though. Thunder crashed on by Wolfie. Vote MBK credit for the kill and Adapting falls for a double for Vote MBK. Deathwalker giving chase, keeping the backline busy, looking for Yamin, avoiding the damage too. And Cyclone still going in. Ice Ice Baby using ambush to close the gap and going in with a blink too. Bit more poke and a great kiss on Yamin, but Yamin's going to pop his boots and run for his life. Still standing for now, but now Dimmy's the next one to be looked at by Cyclone.
What a great jump on an unsuspecting Energy. Energy thought that Cyclone had given up the tier 2 tower. There was no one there, and they walked over 3 sentry wards to find Energy sleeping, getting the double kill on Adapting and Emilito onto Vote MBK. But now, can they even get this tier 2 tower? They've got no tower push.
They're looking for the tier 2 tower with no minions as well. It's going to be a hard ask for themselves as well. Best news is they only lose 2 tier 2 towers against that last Fire Giant as well, aggro, and maybe they can get this one. But Dimmy's still here as well to support, and there's a Fearless juggling Vote MBK, and then Chiron is back. But Wolfie's going to go straight to Chiron, and the trade is on, but the Hunter comes out top.
Just lays the ice and lets Wolfie explode in that ultimate. Just a little bit too aggressive. The rest of Cyclone was so poked out, and now Dimmy still chasing this. No ultimate or blink available.
This is a back and forth between these two teams. I think Dimmy could actually wrap all the way around, but there is sentry wards in the jungle, so he may have to look towards a target. He may not want here. It's going to be Ice Ice Baby first, who Deathbane's away. Fearless now being down means Dimmy can keep forcing him to stop them from backing, and Kallus will actually sacrifice himself. I say that, but Ice Ice Baby's come back in too.
He looks like he's going to want to trade this out for Yamin, and it looks like Kallus is going to live as well.
Kallus, well, Wolfie won't, though, and neither will Kallus, I don't think, at the grand scheme of this. Oh no, he's going to get back up for now and run on the jungle. However, Deathwalker, Force to Cloud, going to go over the wall straight away. No one able to give chase just yet. Cyclone get out, hold their Phoenixes, and end up trading, well, 2-for-1 on a disengage.
That's totally fine. You want to trade out Ice Ice Baby for Yamin at this point in the game, but that last fight before that, whenever they caught Energy sleeping, was the first time that we've seen Ice Ice Baby actually go on Adapting. That's the plan, right? You have Sirket go on to Alquan. He tried to ultimate him that one time by speed buff, but he hasn't had the chance. And that's been mostly because of Adapting's supreme positioning. But that time, Ice Ice Baby catches him sleeping, finally hits the ultimate onto him, and that counter pick potential finally comes to fruition. So Cyclone needs to do a better job of maybe not even putting Ice Ice Baby in the position to be there, but making Adapting come to Ice Ice Baby.
Well, we saw the golden experience difference between the two teams. Energy still in the lead in this game at the moment, but it's not by a lot. You can see the Cyclone are doing a very good job in terms of these engagements, are holding their own for the most part. The hyper carries are starting to hit online now. Freya's really swinging for the houses.
That's true, but Energy's hyper carries are also starting to get there. The Rod of Tahuti completed for Adapting now, the working on that Soul Reaver, and the Rod of Tahuti completed for Emilito as well. So both teams have a lot of late game potential.
Oh, Rafa got picked in the backside. They're going to be aggressed on by the two damage dealers, but will leap away to safety. Kallus now being looked at. Epic uppercut used preemptively from Kallus there. No follow-up, however, from Cyclone. from this time around, so that ult's on cooldown. Meanwhile, Dimmy and Yamin pressuring onto the right-hand side of this fire giant as well, and they're actually splitting Cyclone in terms of the position in the jungle.
Wolfie's had a much tougher game this time. Level 18, he is 2-1, but we're 27 minutes, still not even close to finishing that Rot of Tahuti. Just hasn't had the same impact that he had on the Isis.
Rafa taking a bit of free poke, but Dimmy gets a good Fearless on two. Wolfie's in trouble there. Forced to purify and Sanctuary as well, and Thundercrash, but the Lawbringer will follow that up. Boom from Dimmy. He picks up Wolfie. However, Adapting got to vote and became forced to yield, but Deathwalker brings him down. Ice Baby falls down to Rafa as well, and now Emilito's running for his life as Deathwalker gives chase down. The Mystical Mail should be even enough, but a great stunt from Rafa will keep his carry alive. Yamin, meanwhile, cleans up vote MBK, and Deathwalker is left alone. This is going to be four kills the way of energy.
Oh, and Emilito throwing in some spam laughs, just baiting Deathwalker down, knowing that the Disapparate was going to be up in time. And like you mentioned, a great stun from Raffer saves his life and baits Wolfie in, or excuse me, Deathwalker in, while they were picking up Vote MBK in the back.
What a great team fight, though, from both teams there. The aggression that came up from both.
That really should have been won in spades by Energy, exclusively off that insane Fearless from Dimmy. I mean, he hit 2-3 immediately.
Prime targets as well.
Prime targets immediately into the Soul ult. I mean, that was looking great. And then all of a sudden, Cyclone fights back. They punch back, killing Adapting right away. But Vote, they just had to commit so much. Vote, yep. NBK puts himself in a bad spot, using the Valkyrie's discretion to pick him up, and then just falls in response.
Yeah, Adapting fell down. Emilito was on his last legs there completely. It was just a very good individual play from Rafa to recognize that and support him. And meanwhile, Dimmy, well, he took Wolfie out all on his own.
Dimmy won that team fight for Energy.
And that's all it needs.
That's all you need. That when you have a tier, that's what you want. You want the big blink or alt Fearlesses are coming from behind. It's all about that Fearless combination. And Dimmy finding a huge one. And most importantly, though, Emilito or some damage dealer is there to follow it up, because Dimmy's gone for this pure tank build. He doesn't have that damage that you want, maybe out of like a Jotun's Wrath, Titan's Bane sort of tier, going for this pure facilitator role. And Energy plays it perfectly. Emilito there to drop the Supernova onto 2-3 people instantly off the blink Fearless.
And just to push on Dimmy a little bit more, I mean, he's got this Mystical Mail Sun Wukong to deal with as well. Getting out of combat for that blink isn't the easiest task in the world the whole time either, but he still managed to do it.
That's a good point. Maybe Deathwalker should recognize that and
instead
just negate the engage, because really Dimmy is Energy's engage.
Seems so. Well, the Phoenix is now the prime target here. Dimmy on zone duty around the right, making sure Ice Ice Baby doesn't come in. Kallus took a lot of free pokes there, and there's the blink, but not going to connect this time around. Is Deathwalker, though, was forced to commit there, and he gets poked heavily, forced to ult back out as well.
Almost fell, even with the ultimate, not quite enough damage on the side of Energy, but that's a free ultimate. I mean, Dimmy did have to use the blink, but he still has his ultimate available, can still displace well.
Rafa walks up and just hammers Wolfie in the face there. He's still tanking it up for his team, but they're not in range to really bring down this Phoenix just yet. They'll march on now as Rafa goes in. Underhanded taxis to disarm it, but their eyes, Baby coming in on Adapting again, Adapting forced out. But meanwhile, the damage dealers from Energy doing great work. Yamin and Emilito combining for one, and Kallus is in sleepy time.
Wolfie going up and using the ultimate is not quite enough. Kallus going to fall to Yamin, and the team is still regenning. Emilito still over half health, Adapting half health. That's one Phoenix down, now looking at the middle Phoenix.
They'll get this middle Phoenix for free as well, as Cyclone have to limp back to base and make sure they heal up again, as Energy now going to immediately go for the final one as well. This coerce and the two damage dealers, just too much for two carries.
Just so much structure damage, can't handle it on the side of Cyclone. Now Yamin sitting in the back and be looking at the Titan. A nice double whoop though from MBK.
They can actually find Deathwalker into a very good juggle, and he's already dead before he can get away. Meanwhile, Adapting destroyed Vote MBK there in Energy. Well, it wasn't a great answer back for them, but it was a satisfactory one.
It wasn't even the angry Adapting.
No,
I mean,
wasn't.
That was Emilito and Dimmy sending Cyclone to the Shadow Realm there, not necessarily the alter ego of Adapting.
Not that time round anyway, but Energy do manage to split there against Cyclone. Seeing they managed to split as a surprise, because Cyclone got off to a great start again in game two.
They really did. Just showing a lot of life, it was Cyclone.
Yeah.
And that's going to really, teams are going to look at that set preparing for LAN and be like, we have to watch out for Cyclone, because they look prepared, they look confident, and they're ready to fight.
I mean, for me, Cringe Crew is probably going to be the dark horse in Europe of potentially making the run through to Super Regionals, but maybe Cyclone too now after seeing that against Energy.
Really impressive.
Really
impressive.
Great performance from them, but Energy, they will have themselves in second place for the time being. I believe at the same time we could see Obey come back. But let's go back to Dimmy again. I mean, we mentioned him because you said, you know, it was the turning point of that last engagement.
Just a huge blink Fearless by the these top right mids. You can see it right here, staying just outside of the range of Deathwalker, and there it is, the double Fearless onto both Wolfie and Ice Ice Baby, the Supernova raining down, and then he's like, don't worry, guys, I got Wolfie.
I mean, he followed him the whole way with that as well. He saw the Sanctuary Purification news, then he even went, okay, so his Thunder Crush is down, I'm going to Lawbringer him. I can stay in range as long as I see where he Thunder Crushes to, and then he turns his attention to VotMBK, which we didn't really get to see.
Isn't it kind of messed up that someone named Wolfie just got Fearless and killed because of it? Like, you think Elo Fearless, like Wolfie,
yeah,
tier,
yeah,
but that's a different Wolfie.
Is that the best you got?
Yeah.
Okay.
I thought I was actually kind of proud of that while I was thinking about it. I didn't hear whatever you were saying. It was kind of irrelevant. But, I mean, that, you know, that was kind of ironic.
Well, we do have one of the members of actually Cyclone on the line right now. VotMBK is joining us from that Hunter position. Vote, how you doing, buddy?
I am doing good.
I bet you are. You had a pretty good performance today. Talk us through game one. I mean, you guys came into that one, and for most people at home, they would have expected Energy to win, but you guys got off to a great start. What was that all about, though? What was the big, you know, real reason that got so well?
Yeah, we just picked a really early game core, and then we had a Xing and Apollo in the side lanes for the late game.
Now, that first pick that you got as well onto Rafa at the start of that, was that just executed knowing that he was going to rotate in there because he's done it a few times before? It looked like you sort of pre-planned that a little bit.
Yeah, Hazel was just doing research before we played the games and told us what to do.
So just to add to this as well, then, there's one more question for you, Vote. Is on the side, when you've played before in the SPL, you play with Justice and things, how Cyclone different this time around? You're looking a little bit stronger than I've seen previously, you know, as a whole team. How's the communication and things? Are you guys all on the same page?
Yes, everything is just so much better than it was. The players are better, the team's better, the comms are better. Everything is just going better.
Looking forward to LAN, Vote. How are you guys feeling going into this? This is obviously a big confidence boost, splitting with Energy the week before you head to LAN. Are you guys feeling confident after that?
Yeah, we've been playing pretty good all this week. Big before, we haven't been playing random skins, but all this week we've been playing really, really good. So, we're confident.
Well, it was a great performance from you guys today. Before we let you go, Vote, do you have any shout-outs you want to give?
Shout out to Ice for picking the wrong Hunter in the first game, and shout out to Cyclone.
Ice for picking the wrong Hunter in the first game?
Yeah, everyone went to Shibalonki, he picked Apollo.
Well, it worked out well, right?
Yeah, it did.
So shout-outs to Ice for picking wrong, otherwise you might not have won.
Yeah,
that's my eyes anyway. Congratulations on your win, Vote. Congratulations. We'll see you at LAN in a couple of weeks' time as well. That was the Hunter for Cyclone GG, who just took a game off of Energy. It's not something you get to say too often.
Gotta feel really good right now. I mean, you did lose a second game, but anytime you can take a game off the defending world champions, you're feeling all right.
And with the wrong pick, too.
I mean, it was the right pick, wasn't it?
It was the right pick because you won the game. Anyway, that's it from me and Aggro for now. We'll be back later on today. We've got three more sets to bring you. Enjoy yourselves during the break.